So for something about this, I've had the absolute pleasure of negotiating this GBF that we're talking about together with Carlotta and Anna, and I see others in the room. And I actually cut Malta at the back out of this picture. I feel a little bit guilty about that, seeing him there. If I keep going, do I get my slide? I'll start talking, and if my slide comes, it'll show up. So Carlotta has talked about the birth of this global biodiversity framework that is now soon celebrating its first birthday. And I wanted to use my few minutes to talk about implementation at the international level, and eventually try to come back to this red thread of Sweden's role. First, some comments on the GBF itself. It operates sort of with the same logic as Agenda 2030 and the SDGs, in that it's not a framework just for the Convention on Biodiversity. It's thought to be a sort of all of society global approach. If we're going to achieve it, it requires input and actions and understanding from everybody. The first eight goals are about reducing threats. Do you want to do a switch here? So those are the goals then about the actual sort of conservation and restoration of nature. And then there's a section on meeting people's needs, which goes into a bit what Torsten was talking about. I mean, we have agriculture and other challenges. We've heard about mining. There's a lot of nature on which people are dependent, and that's what's addressed in the middle part of the GBF. And then the last set of goals talks about tools and solutions. We need financing, we need capacity building. It talks about engaging the relevant actors, having a gender perspective with it, etc. So the GBF is not just a plan for the CBD, but for everyone. That was my first point. And this means that other environmental agreements also need to be involved. No worries.
Here it is.
Unfortunately, they are to some degree. When we were negotiating the Global Biodiversity Framework, of course, other biodiversity-relevant frameworks were present, and lobbying, of course, for their interests to be reflected. And here's my illustrative slide. Don't worry, the point isn't to actually be able to read it. I'm going to use it to make some points. You can test your knowledge of international agreements by looking at the icons at the top. We have CITES. Anyone know what that is? Yeah, okay. We have CMS. We have IPPC on plant preservation. We have the new international agreement on this one. I always need to look up Treaty on Plant Genetic Resources for Food and Agriculture. Okay. And whaling is there, Ramsar, conservation of wetlands. And here you see, in a very reduced shorthand form, the targets of the Global Biodiversity Framework. And my point with showing this slide is to say that it's great, a lot of work is already happening. I have a second slide that looks very similar. It has a different set of agreements and processes up at the top, which you'll also recognize. There's Agenda 2030, the Desertification Convention, the Climate Convention, Basel, Rotterdam, and Stockholm on chemicals and waste and POPs, and the last one is Minamata on mercury. So here, and the point I'm showing this set is clearly it covers different parts of the GBF, where the biodiversity related conventions on the previous slide were weaker on the tools and implementation and stronger on the conservation restoration parts. Some of these compensate. There's another point to it, though, and that is just that these boxes are checked. It doesn't mean that these are all working towards the same aims and purposes, there's also a risk for conflict when you have multiple agreements working on the, in the same areas, but perhaps with different objectives. And the sort of low-hanging fruit of examples here, of course, is climate change and biodiversity, which I'll take since it was already lifted. But you can plant trees as a climate mitigation action to help the climate. It doesn't really matter what kind of trees. It could be a large monocrop, which could be devastating for biodiversity. And at the moment, at least at the conference of the party level, there's no way for international environment agreements to talk to each other officially. Sometimes we're the same negotiators sitting in one or the other, but they can't communicate. And so there's a process now called the Bern process on synergies between biodiversity-related agreements, which I have the pleasure of co-chairing right now with together with Mexico. And there the idea is to bring representatives of all of these environmental agreements that you see here and some others, and a broad representation from relevant civil society and indigenous peoples and local communities together to discuss how we can implement the GBF together in a synergistic manner. And I said I wanted to come back to the red thread, which is Sweden's role. And one way that we are, and this has already been mentioned by Charlotte, but I think one way we can punch above our little Swedish weight sometimes is exactly by leading international processes. We can do a lot of really good things at home. We can also do some not so good things at home, particularly in the forestry sector. We're often quite good at process, and that's an export. And Sweden also has... is often seen as an honest broker, in part through a lot of the work we do through CETA. We have broad connections around the world, and that allows us to do quite a lot of things that just operating at the national level we wouldn't be able to achieve. We also took the opportunity during our recent presidency of the EU Council, the first half of this year, to get the EU Working Group on Biodiversity, which Charlotta and some colleagues were chairing, and the EU Working Group on Climate Change to coordinate. It sounds like something that one would expect, particularly at an EU level, to happen automatically. But it doesn't, and it never had, and it meant that civil servants all over Europe working with biodiversity had to find their counterparts working with climate change and talk to them and actually agree on something. So there's small ways which can actually achieve quite big results. I think that's something that we've been able to come with. Which also for me illustrates that international agreements like the GBF have a value beyond sort of the ink on the page. There's often the critique, particularly from individuals and organizations working on the ground, the environmental rights defenders, that, oh, we've spent 4 years moving commas around on a page, what does it achieve? But it catalyzes at the national level, at the regional level, the subnational level, conversations that help us to put in place the tools and the review mechanisms that was also just mentioned to start working towards these goals. And it also leads to conversations like the one that we're having here. And I think that's all I want to say. Thank you.